energetic Northchurch resident by the name of George Meager joined the ranks of enthusiastic cameramen using 8mm Kodachrome. Instead of just filming his family like most of us, he became something of a roving reporter, covering various events of the village. And when he died in 1971, that film was passed on to the Northchurch Society for posterity and is now held for safety in the vaults of the National Film Archive. With their help, the Society has been able to make it available for everybody by putting some of it together to produce this video. This is Northchurch Village on a day in September 1990. Full of exhaust fumes and very noisy. Huge lorries dominate the ever-increasing numbers of private cars that use this stretch of the A41 throughout the day. It's become almost impossible to cross the road, as this friendly cyclist is about to discover. But it wasn't always like this, and what you are about to see is an active, involved, and happy community of Northchurch, 1966. Let's start with a comparison. The same piece of village and the same few shoppers. But now, ladies, just look at those clothes and hairstyles. How many faces can you recognise? You might even see yourself. There's Mrs. Dilling, and isn't that Miss Curl? I wonder who this is with her children. There's no doubt that's Roy Harris. Crossing the road is definitely easier. Here's the same butcher's shop, but much busier. Everybody seems to look happier, or is it just imagination? He certainly does, but after a busy morning, you can work up quite a thirst, and where better to quench it than the Georgian Dragon. Here comes Harry Durrant for the first pint of the day. There's a sight for a dry throat. Ah, that's better. The bar is as lively as ever, with our star pianist on the ivories, George Meager himself. How do you do that, George? Play and film yourself at the same time? A clever man, our George. From one set of ivories to the other kind they call dominoes. And with it, the companionship and light-hearted banter of other villagers, like Billy Howlett and Arthur Preston. And at the bar, Roy Morgan. Cheers, landlord. There's Roy Harris again, starting a game of darts with the younger age group. It was always a good atmosphere, and although there was no fancy food, you could be certain of a good ploughman. There's the glamorous Wyn Mead, who's shared a joke with mine host. Time has not changed this scene. but about the past in this village of ours. This view of Northchurch was taken by Bob Gardner, and the rooftops indicate the area of old property from Victorian times, with the more recent styles of building surrounding it. In those early days, Dars Lane was at the western end. Bell Lane to the east, Alma Road to the south, and at the centre of everything, St Mary's Church. One of the oldest in Hertfordshire, with pre-Norman walls, it took its present form around 1220. This Tottenhoe stone tower, recently restored, houses the peal of 8 bells, 4 of which were cast by the famous bell founder Chandler, and are dated 1651. They're very rare. The whole church itself was restored in 1881 with the addition of a north aisle, a north vestry, and a south porch. But here comes Reverend Hughes for today's service, a much-loved man and resident for some 20-odd years. He was instrumental in building a strong and regular congregation during the 60s, right up to his retirement in 1975. Let's see if there is anybody we can identify. There is Mrs. Penn and Mr. Catherall. They say it always rains on Sunday, but there's no sign of it today. And that's Evelyn TP with his youngest. And Paul Odgers, I do believe. There's a pretty young miss. And here's the rector's wife, Mrs. Hughes, and their son. And they just made it. This very fine Spanish painting dates from the 1700s. Those not at church, it is their opportunity to catch up with nature's progress at the allotment. Nice one, Ernie Skidmore. And so is that. The Northchurch team was very active in those days, and Sunday morning was usually the only available time for practice. What some of them lacked in ability was more than made up for with enthusiasm. Great stuff, lads. While still others in the village went for their Sunday morning walk up on the common, accompanied by their dogs, a guarantee to sharpen the taste buds and work up a healthy appetite. Then there were those who went for their morning ride, probably partaking of a small libation beforehand. Purely in the interests of tradition, of course. They were also accompanied by their four-legged friends. But weekends pass all too quickly, and once again it is Monday. And for these children, it's school. Those precious days of early learning, but desperately wanting to be grown up. The strange thing is that with the benefit of film, they now are. These youngsters are today in their late 20s and early 30s, probably with children of their own, who also play games in this same playground, but not under the watchful eye of Fred Phillips. Let us leave the mums outside waiting for their offspring and see how many of you can recognize yourselves. Among these faces were Elaine Gardner, Anne Barley, and Jean Wilson. Did you spot them? My goodness, what a difference a piece of discipline makes. The future generation of young ladies with the well-known figures of Mrs. Orchard and Mrs. Phillips. For the boys, it's camp, with all the excitement of doing something yourself, from hoisting the flag to erecting tents and all the cooking. Although I don't think many mothers would approve of this particular style. As I recall, the food in general always did taste a bit smoky. But now it's all hands to work in preparation for tonight's big event and sing-song. By the look of all that wood and those logs, we shall be neither cold nor in the dark. Now there's a handsome blaze, and it looks as though Dennis Shirley is calling for one finger, one thumb. It's a popular action song with the youngsters, usually to keep them warm, but not with this fire. Feeling the heat, lad? Parents are also here to join their sons in the fun and the singing, although she looks preoccupied. But all too soon, it's time for turning in. The fire dies down, and for the adults, it's lighting up the last cigarette of the evening. So it's good night from him, and it's good night from him. The new day dawns, and for the closing parade service, which Jack Reynolds supervises, it is time to lower the flag on this camp. In readiness for the big event of the year. The Garden Fete, and Man Master Shepherd is doing us proud today with lively music to last all afternoon, mixed with some pop songs of the year. More people arriving. It looks as though it might be a busy day. There's Colonel Johnson making the opening announcements. And Rector Bernard Hughes is lending a last-minute hand with some chairs. So, roll up, you pays your money, and you takes your choice. And plenty of choice there is too. Let's start with something original. Another facet of George Meagher's incredible talent. Fairground models, splendidly created, with such fine detail and fully operational. The traction engine looks so real, as indeed do the swings and flying boats. What infinite patience to work on such a miniature scale. And there's the real thing. Whoever owns that had no trouble in parking. Being such a beautiful day, tea and cake on the rectory lawn is a must. There are Mayor and Winnie Ecclesfield. Annie East and Mrs. Greenwood. Having enjoyed that sit down, it's time to see what is on offer at the cake stall. As well as trying your skill on the hoopla. Or bowling. Or various other stalls. What a marvellous array of bottles. Perhaps a pony ride is more to your taste. Well, as you can see, Northchurch was a popular place in 1966. That is quite a crowd. I should imagine the whole village has turned out. Why, there's the literary Lavender Loxley at the bookstall. And there's Edwin Dell, playing the jovial gent at the dart stall. Here we have Mrs. Graham. Mrs. Hales. Hilary T.P. and Jackie Hosier. Stan Harris, of course. Mrs. Cook. Horace Bruton, Alice Bruton, Mrs. Cowtree, and Mrs. Bruton. How nice it is to see all the Bruton family together. But the most hilarious event of the day had to be that provided by the fire brigade. Hose football. Does Arsenal know about this strategy? Oops! However, for those of us not quite so energetic, a breather on the water is most welcome.
small, I know she must be kind.
Mind you, it's a busy stretch of the canal just here with the lock gates doing overtime. It is quite surprising how many people actually live on the waterways in narrowboats, aside from the small cargoes also transported. There is naturally a considerable number of pleasure craft in regular use as well. Northchurch is such an attractive spot during the summer, but come the winter and it can be very treacherous. Did anybody recognise the orchard corner of Bell Lane before it was developed? What a bleak and deserted look. Can this really be the A41? With not a vehicle in sight? For the residents, however, it's time to get out the brooms and shovels to clear the snow and slush from the pavements, particularly for the old folk. Although Charlie Bunn is not exactly in any hurry. Meanwhile, outside the George and Dragon, George Allen is more in luck. He has the opportunity to rest and admire the passing scenery. But thank goodness the bad weather did not last long. Duncan looks its normal self again, and with spring just around the corner, it's time to put tools in order and sharpen up in readiness. These two, Mr. Loveridge and his wife, real tinkers without a shadow of doubt, never fail to make the rounds of all the local villages in early spring. The quality of the sharpening was not all that could be desired, but it was on the spot, and they collected a sizeable custom. Whilst that's going on, let us take a look round the village. To begin with, Bell Lane itself has changed. Nearly all these cottages have been altered, but I'm glad to say that their character was retained when they were renovated and brought up to modern standards. In a minute we shall see a young Bert Hosier pushing his cycle up the hill. But if Bell Lane is a surprise, how about Alma Road with its row of Victorian cottages which were demolished in the 70s to make way for a new development? There's Roy Morgan, with Billy Howlett, deciding who is going to do the demonstration for George's camera. This little lady seems in a hurry. Who's chasing her, I wonder? Ah, a machine from vintage days. Arthur Preston with his redoubtable motorcycle and sidecar. Looks like an AJS. That's the demonstration. What on earth would Roy Morgan be carrying in those buckets? Beer? Looks as though somebody's got a birthday. I think it's going to be a full house, with all those going. But Emmy Welling is off in another direction. Here's a real Victorian lady, the well-known Miss Bignall. It's spring and the beginning of a new season. Instance of cricket. Perfect for a lazy afternoon, as the song says. Lazy perhaps for the spectators, but the team is active enough. Come the break for tea, we should probably find a few familiar faces among the team and the supporters. Like Kifford Geary and his wife. The sandwiches look good too. Roy Harris. And there's Harry Meager, George's father, who incidentally was a great sportsman. There is another keen sportsman, Cecil Woodford, who eventually became an umpire for the team. As they resume play, let us pay a visit to something unexpected George took his camera to, a steam rally. It was not held in Northchurch, but George went to film one of its popular residents, Derek Petty, who had a traction engine which he used for his forestry work. This is another traditional use, operating roundabouts and sideshows at fairgrounds and generating electricity for lighting. Just listen to that evocative music from the steam organ you can see just beyond the horses. There's a handsome machine of the fairground livery. Beautiful red and gold paintwork and gleaming brass. There is no doubt these machines create a particular fascination for all ages. As Derek Petty said, it's something about the majesty of the engine and its power. When you have one, you almost dedicate yourself to it, keeping it in tip-top condition. It's also, of course, the love of steam. His wife, Gwen, looks as proud of this great beast as he was. The value of the traction engine for Derek was the towing of felled trees. They're also worth a great deal of money, ranging between £25,000 to £65,000. There is Derek now, involved in one of the races. Yes, these monsters really do race at speeds between 4 and 8 miles per hour. They have 5 to 8 horsepower engines. Machines used in farming or road work were traditionally either black and green or brown and cream in colour. Here's a better view of the steam organ we saw earlier. With its cymbals and bass drum as well, it's the steam version of a one-man band. The finals are now on, with Derek and his friend Don Hartman doing well. But we have to leave them now, as we have come full circle to the annual fete for 1967. The weather hasn't smiled so kindly on us this year. Fortunately, the band is in good form to counteract what seems to be a very grey start. It's not as crowded either. But there's a special event later. And apart from that, we have the popular pony rides and the usual run of stalls. There's the handkerchief tree at the back. I've also just seen the three familiar faces of Jack Gates, Dorothy Berry and Lavender Loxley. See who you can spot. Now, for the special event, Fluff heralds something particularly for the children. A maypole. Dancing to that old folk tune, Nuts in May, arranged in the musical round version. It has attracted a large crowd, where we can see Ivor Evans with his tiny charge, who has had enough of standing. And there's Bert Hosey's wife and daughter. Thank you, boys and girls. That was delightful. Now let me leave you to enjoy the music while you find some more friends or relations. Well, it's home for these two, and for us as well. We have come to the end of this trip down memory lane, and I'm sure you will agree that it's been quite special to see our village of 25 years ago through the courtesy of George Meagher's delightful photography, albeit just a small sample of the heritage he left behind. Thank you, George. All of us at Northchurch are very grateful.